Welcome back, everybody. We've made it to the top 20 of this list of the Nathaniel Ahart Company's top 100 greatest films of all time. And joining me today, we have a very, very special guest. He's been on the channel before, and this is his first time back on in well over a year, Mr. Alex Premo. How are we doing today, good sir?
Very good, Nathaniel. Thanks for having me on the show. Glad to be here.
Absolutely, man. How excited are you to get into the top 20 movies here?
Oh, I'm thrilled. I'm just absolutely, this has been a great list so far, and I really can't wait to see what lies ahead, so can't wait.
All right.
Yeah, well, in that case, let's not waste any time, and let's crack the top 20, starting with number 20. Now, you know what they say, Alex. There's no place like home. The Wizard of Oz, directed by Victor Fleming from 1939. I mean, talk about the definition of iconic, and also the highest ranked musical film on this list. I'm actually surprised. I thought Singing in the Rain would have been higher, but I guess that this is the one that lands at the top. And while I do not think that this is a better film than Singing in the Rain by any means, it's certainly one of the most iconic films ever made, which is probably why it finds a spot in the top 20. I mean, who does not know this movie? I feel like even like little children know about this movie, and it came out like over 80 years ago, which I think is the definition of an absolute staple in cinema. And the fact, like, we obviously already talked about Gone with the Wind in the first episode. The fact he came out with this and The Wizard of and Gone with the Wind in the same year is, like, insane to me, because they're both so epic in scope and so innovative in so many ways. And, of course, I mean, this is what most people would consider, like, the perfect adaptation of the Frank Baum book. And just the revolutionary idea that transition between black and white and Technicolor. I mean, there was nothing like it when it came out, and sure, there are movies that have tried to replicate that style and that feeling since, but nothing will ever be like when Dorothy walked through that door and walked into Oz for the very first time with Toto. I mean, it's just one of the most iconic, one of the most beautiful images of all time, and my goodness, the songs in here as well. I mean, Somewhere Over the Rainbow, it's one of the greatest songs written for any movie. It might as well be the greatest song written for any movie, and won the Oscar deservedly so, as did the score, which is absolutely incredible. I mean, how can you not love the music in this film? And so many, I mean, is it called We're Off to See the Wizard, or The Wonderful Wizard of Oz, or The Wizard of Oz? I don't know. It's just, you know it, but I don't know what the title is.
Yeah, I'm not sure on that one.
Yeah, but still, everybody knows We're Off to See the Wizard. I mean, it's just so iconic. And, of course, you have so many iconic characters in here. Of course, Ray Bolger is the Scarecrow. Of course, Jack Haley is the Tin Man. Burt Lahr is the Cowardly Lion, who's just, oh my goodness, so amazing. Margaret Hamilton is the Wicked Witch of the West, man. I mean, one of the most iconic. I'll get you, my pretty. You know, everyone knows her and that evil, evil look. Stayed with her the rest of her life, even though I hear she was a very kind lady in reality, and even showed up on Mr. Rogers. But of course, this really was the breakout performance of an absolute screen icon in Judy Garland as Dorothy Gale here. My goodness, one of the best debuts of any actor ever. I mean, cinema was never the same again once Judy Garland graced the screen for the very first time in this film. Absolutely incredible what she does, and cemented herself as one of the legends of the silver screen. But really, everybody else is really great in here. Frank Morgan is the wizard, you know. I mean, what an iconic character. And I just love this. This is the example of simplicity done right. You know, like, it isn't a very complex story, but the ideas are so strong and so relatable to so many people. It's like finding the strength within yourself that perhaps you didn't know you had. which is just such a timeless theme, and I think maybe that's why this film has resonated so long and for all this time, really. My only thing with it, this was not on my list, believe it or not, and I don't know, I always go back and forth on The Wizard of Oz, because I think it's an amazing film, obviously. Like, I can't argue it making the top 20, even though I'd probably have it a bit lower. But the whole thing with when they go into Munchkin Land and they're singing, like, Follow the Yellow Brick Road or whatever, I just feel like the way they pitch up their voices, I feel like that was a very kind of, like, 1930s stereotype of, like, little people, and it just doesn't really hold up, and it also just annoys the shit out of me. Like, it just sounds terrible, and it's annoying, and it gets on my nerves. But other than that, I mean, there isn't really anything wrong with this movie. This is a splendid, splendid film that obviously, it's, like, the definitive children's film. Even though, like, adults can relate to it just as much and be... I mean, my goodness, I mean, that ending brings tears to my eyes every time I see it. Just with the sweeping score, of course, and the musical motifs. I mean, this is an incredible movie. So, yeah, as I said, like, you can't really argue against its laurels, and I'm glad to see it on the list.
Yeah, man, I completely agree with everything you just said. I mean, this is truly one of the most iconic movies of all time. A special effects pioneer. Yeah. The costumes are brilliant.
Dude, the monkeys.
Yeah, exactly.
So I mean, scary to this
yes,
day.
Yes, yes. Just everything about it is really thanks to the magic of cinema. So, yeah, it's well-deserved to be on this list in this position, I think.
Cool. Did you have it this high on your list?
Good question. I'm not sure.
But it was on your list.
It was. Yeah.
Okay. That makes sense. I feel like I'm the odd man out in that sense, but... You know, even so, it's like it's an amazing film. So as I said, I am happy to see it on here nonetheless. So great, great choice. And that is going to take us now to number 19.
Is this the year you can't hear on? George Bailey, I'll love you till the day I die.
It's A Wonderful Life, directed by Frank Capra from 1946. My goodness, look, guys, this should be in the top 10. As you all know, probably based on my review I did right at Christmas time, this is my favorite film ever made. I think that this is like the greatest story that has ever been told in the cinematic medium. So granted, I do think it should be a bit higher on this list, but my goodness, what Capra does he... This is the thing that's so amazing about Capra, and I really wish that there was, like... I would have thought that Mr. Smith Goes to Washington would have made this list, but unfortunately it didn't, and I think that was a bit of a snub. But I think the thing that was so amazing about Capra is he was able to pull out these really complex ideas, but also add, like, sentimentality to it as well, and not in a way that feels cloying, but in a way that feels entirely earned. And I think that this is... As I've said many times before, this story is the definition of payoff. The way they build, you know, this community in Bedford Falls, all centered around George Bailey here, played by the legendary James Stewart, in what is one of the greatest screen performances of all time, I think. The embodiment of the everyman. And just, I once again, I mean, he's such a relatable character because anybody can... see the struggle that he's going through in perhaps their own personal lives, about kind of like that idea, that grappling with the idea of wanting to do something more with your life, but being confined to one place, and how he almost feels like his life is worthless. But then you see the impact he has had on so many people's lives within the community, within his family, and it just goes to show that even the little gestures add up to something greater than the sum of their parts. And I mean, this whole cast is amazing. I can't believe that, like, nobody was, like, nominated for this movie besides James Stewart, and the fact he didn't win, I think, is one of the greatest crimes that the Academy Awards ever committed. But Donna Reed... Oh my goodness, some of the greatest chemistry I've ever seen in my life between her and James Stewart. She's just so radiant every time she steps on the screen. The way her face lights up every time George Bailey walks into the room. Oh my goodness, just one of the most badass women in film in a very, you know, kind of like normal way. Lionel Barrymore is Mr. Potter, one of the most despicable villains of all time. He's just pure evil. But yet he isn't like a two-dimensional character either. Like, he's legitimately smart, and you understand like how he understands to get around these situations. He's very manipulative, and you see that throughout the entire movie. One of the best villains of all time. Obviously, Thomas Mitchell as Uncle Billy is so great, and I mean, one of the best character actors ever. And dude, one who I think should have been nominated as well, besides Lionel Barrymore and Donna Reed, Henry Travers as Clarence in here. When he comes into the movie, I mean, he just lights up the screen and steals the whole thing. Not only does he bring so much humor to it, but he also brings this message of this film around full circle, telling George, you know, you really did have a wonderful life. And my goodness, I mean, there's so many moments in here, whether it be the scene where they have their honeymoon, is one, maybe the most romantic scene in any film, or just the ever so iconic ending, which I think is the greatest ending to any film. And I mean, I guess we could spoil it. I mean, not that I'm going to, but you know, if it comes up, like everyone knows it. I mean, it's this high on the list. I think this is a lot, but my goodness, when everyone comes and gives George Bailey that money, it is the definition of paying it forward. And I mean, I'm sobbing every time I finish this movie. How can you not be moved by this film? It really is like the greatest ending that anybody could ever think up. And I don't think there's ever going to be a film with a better ending than this. I mean, I don't think there's ever going to be a better film than this in the history of cinema. I just think the definitive feel-good story, which also goes in some really dark and complicated places. I mean, this is an absolute masterpiece. The best Christmas movie by extension, but I don't think people should limit it to such. And I think the fact that it is this high on this list, I don't feel people do.
Yeah, well, I mean, like you said, there's a reason why this has become such a classic over the years. I mean, it's so enjoyable to watch. I mean, you know, really, Christmas wasn't that long ago, so I rewatched it recently, so it's pretty fresh in my mind. Everything you said, the performances, all the characters are brilliant. The script is brilliant. It's just, it truly is a beautiful, beautiful film.
Yeah, and it might be, it's definitely one of the greatest screenplays ever written. I think it's one of the best directed films ever, though it's in a much more subtle way. It's not as flashy as something like, you know, like a Stanley Kubrick film or whatever. But also, I just think the fact that this was kind of forgotten about, it got mixed reviews when it came out, which is unbelievable to me. Like, I don't know how this movie comes out and you don't automatically think it's a masterpiece. Because I even the first time I watched this many, many years ago, like, I knew that this was an incredible, incredible movie. And maybe I wasn't as into film as I am now. But the fact that it was kind of like it fell into the public domain or whatnot, and then it started getting reran on Christmas on cable. And now it's like considered this seminal classic of not just Christmas, but in cinema in general. It astounds me, but I think it goes to show the shelf life of this thing and how a film can kind of come back over time and really make that impact that I don't think I otherwise would have had if it, you know, just came out. And look, that's not to say that there aren't films that just came out and were classics immediately, but this one took a while, and I think it has cemented itself over some other films that were well acclaimed when they came out. And I mean, this is really one of the most iconic, one of the most beautifully written tales ever created, and what I think to be the greatest film of all time. And so, yeah, amazing, amazing choice. Should be higher, but you know, I'm glad it wasn't not in the top 20. You know what I mean? I would have been mad if it was like in the top 30 or something, but absolutely deserving of a spot this high on the list. And that is going to take us, guys, to number 18.
It's a very unusual knife. I've never seen one like it. Neither had the storekeeper who sold it to the boy. Aren't you asking us to accept a pretty incredible coincidence?
I'm just saying a coincidence is possible.
And I say it's not possible.
Where did that come from?
It's the same knife.
Thank you, dude.
Where did you get it?
12 Angry Men, directed by Sidney Lumet from 1957. Wow, I did not expect this film to be this high on the list, but I mean, what can I say? Another masterpiece on this list. And look, this is, you know, we talked about Reservoir Dogs, obviously. This is the best film to take place in one location. The fact that this film, and I think it goes to show how high it is on this list, everyone feels that way. The fact they are able to make this situation so riveting in just a singular space gives a lot of credit to Lumet's direction. You know, just the camera work itself, the editing, and of course, the acting. Oh my goodness, some of the greatest, most intense performances here, especially from Henry Fonda as juror number 8, who really is the driving force of this whole narrative. As soon as he stabs that knife into the table, you know you're in for something here. And I mean, the cast that rounds us out as well is amazing. I definitely have to mention, above everyone else, Lee J. Cobb in here. Is absolutely, you know, the one who really kind of gives Henry Fonda some sort of like back and forth in some tension and some conflict. I feel like the story doesn't work without him, and I feel like that's, you know, a lot of the reason why there's this continued sort of conflict throughout the movie. But my goodness, it just the fact that the way they break down like this case, the way you see people's preconceived biases going into this case, whether it be racially speaking or just personally, like, oh, I know there was one guy who just wanted to go to a baseball game and he was like, let's just get out of here, I'm going to call him guilty, without even taking a second to think about the implications that could have on a young man's life. I mean, it's incredible the way they kind of go about this, and the way they break it down to the nitty gritty. It really is not, there isn't like a single stone left unturned in this film when it comes down to breaking down the details of this case, the possible outcomes, what could have happened, what could have not happened. Every fact is disputed in this and leaves a lot of reasonable doubt in this case. And I think that this is an example of the American justice system working at perhaps the highest level. And I think that this movie should be a must-watch for anybody who goes and has jury duty, because I don't know how you can't watch this and kind of think, okay, like, I need to remove myself from, you know, from, like, my own head, from this situation, and really look at this objectively in the best way I possibly can. I think it's such an inspirational film. It's beyond riveting from start to finish. And, yeah, I had this in my top 50. I didn't have it this high. But obviously, yeah, it deserved to be on this list. It is an absolute classic in cinema. And, yeah, really, really glad to see it. The only Sidney Lumet film, believe it or not. But if there was anyone that was deserving of the accolade to be on this list, I think this is the one.
So I saw this film for the first time in my 8th grade English class.
Mm.
We had read the play. And then we watched the film, and even then, it totally knocked my socks off. I was completely floored the first time I saw this movie. And it really, like you said, gives an interesting perspective on the American justice system and, you know, showing it the way it should work. And it's just, like you said, so riveting. It's every single second of this film. And I'm usually not huge into movies that take place in one spot.
Right.
You're totally suckered into this. It's just, it really is deserving of this spot, I think.
Absolutely. And dude, the fact, like, this was only nominated for 3 Oscars and it
didn't win any of them.
Which was Best Picture, Best Director, and Best Adapted Screenplay. Which, I mean, I'm sure those 3, you know, were the deserved ones. But, like, dude, Henry Fonda and Lee J. Cobb, that doesn't make any sense to me.
No.
I think they were really off the ball with this one, because this probably should have... I forgot what won in 57, but this probably should have won Best Picture. I don't even doubt it for 2 seconds. But, yeah, I mean, this is an amazing film. And I think, as time has shown, it doesn't even matter what they were saying about it at the Oscars back then, because it ended up this high on the list. So everyone feels a strong way about this film. And I think we both do as well. So really, really glad to see 12 Angry Men on the list. And amazing choice. That's going to take us to number 17. Seven Samurai from 1954, directed by, once again, Akira Kurosawa. The highest film that's non-English on this list, and I think that comes as no surprise because, I mean, come on, what is the most iconic foreign language film of all time? Probably this one right here, and I think easily the most influential, for sure. I mean, look at, as we were talking about with Rashomon, like, look at how influential this template is for every film that followed, whether it be, like, The Magnificent Seven, or even A Bug's Life, for that matter. I mean, Pixar stole this film. I mean, let's be honest here. We can't beat around the bush. But I think besides just the plotting of this film, and the characterization of these, you know, characters that populate this narrative, it's really the filmmaking that put this film on the next level. As we know, Akira Kurosawa is one of the masters of cinema. And just the impact that this film has from an action standpoint. I mean, we wouldn't have films like Raiders of the Lost Ark. We wouldn't have Star Wars. We wouldn't have any of these films if it weren't for the revolutionary techniques that Kurosawa broke through with this film. And my goodness, some of the most mind-blowing action sequences still to this day. It's absolutely breathtaking and riveting when you watch it, especially the whole third act of this film. And my goodness, this film is like over 3.5 hours long, or just about. And you might feel the length a little bit, but it never drags. You're just locked in the whole time to the story about these seven samurais trying to like save the village from these bandits. And what we learn about all these characters along the way is what really keeps you invested, because there isn't a whole lot of action until maybe the last hour. It really is a lot of just learning about these characters and what their deal is. And my goodness, I mean, so many standouts in this cast, but I definitely have to mention Takashi Shimura, who is so great in every Akira Kurosawa film, whether it be Ikiru or Rashomon or Yojimbo. I mean so many. But to me, Toshiro Mifune, as always, especially in this film as Kukichiro, I think that this is his best performance that I've seen. I think he is by far the most compelling, the most entertaining character in this film, and I think he gives like an emotional weight to this film that a lot of other characters don't even have, you know, the capacity of doing. And my goodness, you can see why Mifune was really Kurosawa's ace in the hole, if you will. I mean, he was in so many films, and with good reason, because he was probably the greatest Japanese actor to ever live. I don't think that's really a stretch to say. And I mean, oh my goodness, you know what's even crazier? I believe that Tatsuya Nakari got his first role in this film, and obviously went on to, you know, star in Ron and so many, you know, a few other Kurosawa films, you know, on top of all the other films that he's been in. But my goodness, I mean, what can you say about this movie that hasn't been said before? It's been copied, it's been borrowed, whatever you want to call it, but nothing really comes close. Any remake comes close to what Akira Kurosawa accomplished with this film. From 1954. It is a timeless masterpiece. I think Akira Kurosawa's best film. And while I had it a bit lower for my own personal sake, I've only seen it one time, believe it or not. I've been meaning to come back to this film. I mean, I can't argue it being in the top 20. And I'm glad to see a film that's, you know, a non-English language film make it this high on the list, because, yeah, we had a few right below it, like Parasite and a few others, but I mean, it makes sense that this is the one to take the top spot.
Totally. I mean, so I've only seen this film once too, and mm-hmm. I assume it was probably around the same time you did. But still, in my mind, the like you said, the action sequences, the acting, even the cinematography is just all so revolutionary. And it's like you said, it invented this whole idea of getting the team together, you know?
Yeah.
Assemble the team, and that's, like you said, a trope that we still see today. So, I mean, this is just such an inventive and creative film, and I'm happy to see it on the list.
Absolutely, man. And yeah, I mean, look, there were a lot of Japanese films on this list too, like probably around 4 or 5, I want to say. And yeah, I mean, this is, I think it's the best one out of all of them make the list. And really glad to see Akira Kurosawa get mentioned here a couple of times. Because, yeah, especially with this film, because, I mean, everyone remembers him for so many great films, but this is the one that people talk about the most, and rightfully so. So, amazing choice, guys, and now that will take us to number 16. Dun da dun 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 da da. Yes, Raiders of the Lost Ark from 1981, directed by none other than Steven Spielberg. Oh my goodness. We were just talking about Seven Samurai and the effect that Kurosawa had on filmmakers like George Lucas and, of course, Steven Spielberg. And I think this is probably the film I think culminated in the most, well, not maybe not the most success, but I think with the best results. This was in my top 20. This is one of the greatest films ever made. The definitive action adventure blockbuster, if there ever was one. And my goodness, one of the most iconic and legendary characters of all time. And Dr. Henry Jones, aka Indiana Jones, portrayed by Harrison Ford. And probably, well, I mean, you could say Han Solo's his best role, but my goodness, man, this is just what an amazing character. What he brings to this role, the charisma, the physicality, the wit, everything about this character is just the definition of iconic. And the characters that populate this narrative as well. I mean, come on. Marion Ravenwood, Karen Allen, my goodness. Yet again, one of the most badass women to ever walk onto the face of, you know, the silver screen here. And I mean, just so breathtakingly gorgeous as well. She really is Indy's equal in every single way. And just, my goodness, you couldn't ask for a better companion. I don't want to call her an indie sidekick, but I think out of all the characters that have come out throughout the Indiana Jones series, she's probably my favorite, honestly. She's just one of the best ever to grace the screen in this franchise. But of course, I mean, Sala, John Rhys-Davies, I mean, one of his, the only Indiana Jones character that's been in more than three movies. Besides Indiana Jones himself. So obviously one of the most iconic allies that he's ever had. And the villains in here too, of course, Major Tote here. Oh my goodness, one of the creepiest villains ever walk onto the screen. Of course, you know, so many actors in here as well. You know, Alfred Molina shows up at the beginning as Satipo. Yep. Just so iconic, that whole opening going into the runes to get the fertility idol, and of course the moving with the sand, and of course the boulder chase. Everything about this movie has been, you know, replicated so many times, like we were saying with Seven Samurai. It's just such a pop culture landmark, but the action itself is so incredible. You get so wrapped up in these action set pieces, especially when they're going through the market in Cairo. It's one of like my favorite sequences in Indiana Jones movie. And the John Williams score, absolutely amazing, one of his absolute best, as you know, everyone knows the Raiders March and then some. But dude, just that, back to that Cairo scene, man, I absolutely love one of the, probably the best improvised, well, maybe not the best improvised moment on film, but when that swordsman swinging around the sword and then Indy just shoots him, and the fact that it's like Harrison Ford had dysentery or something, he's like, I can't stay out here, so he just decided to shoot him, and made the film 10 times better, and everybody remembers that being the like the laugh out loud moment of the film. But I mean, yet again, as I was saying with the dialogue here, it's still so witty, it's so fresh, it's so hysterical. Even though this film taking place in like 1936 or whatever, and the Nazis are on the threshold of kind of trying to conquer the world, everything about it still, it feels like such a timeless film. Everything about this is just amazing. And dude, one of the best stunts I've ever seen, dude, that desert chase sequence. Oh my goodness. Yeah. And one of the best pieces John Williams ever composed. Dude, as soon as you see him riding that horse in the John Williams score cues up, it makes me lose my mind every time. But when he's like going under the truck with the whip, the fact that Harrison Ford actually like did all his stunts back then, it is just so impressive to watch this action play out. Like, nothing about this is impractical. It is all done in camera, and I think that's it gives this film a sort of authenticity that a lot of other films didn't have. The same thing with Seven Samurai, obviously, since that was filmed in the 50s. But I think action adventure films like this are really kind of hard to top or replicate. Like, that's why I wonder what's going to happen with Dial of Destiny, because, I mean, let's be honest, we've seen a bit of the CGI in the trailer. There was nothing like that in this film. But then again, the practical effects are amazing. I mean, I don't care spoiling this movie. We made the top 20. You probably have all seen it. But, dude, like, when they open the arc and, like, their faces are melting off, oh, my goodness, that's, like, one of the creepiest, one of the most groundbreaking special effects I've ever seen. I don't know. This isn't even my favorite Spielberg film, right? And it's this high on my list, and it's this high on this list. I mean, how can you not love this film? It's absolutely amazing. One of the greatest ever made. Deserves to be this high. Number 16 on this list.
It's one of my favorite movies of all time. Probably in my top five. every time I watch this movie, it feels like it's the first time. It's just so, everything about it is pitch perfect. I think the script is perfect, the pacing is perfect, just the characters, the acting, everything about it. It's just so much fun, and it's so entertaining, and it's really a great showcase, I think, of what movies are all about. It's truly one of the best.
Yeah, man. And this is another one, should have won Best Picture. I mean, who remembers Chariots of Fire? I mean, some people do, but no disrespect to Vangelis. I know we were talking about him earlier with Blade Runner, and that score is amazing. But, like, John Williams, the Raiders March is all you need to really know that he deserved to win the Oscar, as well as the Desert Chase sequence. But, my goodness, one of the most iconic scores of all time, one of the most iconic characters.
The Raiders March alone.
Yeah.
But then you get everything on top of that.
Dude, and I love when the theme of the arc. Mm-hmm. Like, oh dude, that's just, it's so swelling, it's so gigantic, it's so looming. I mean, how can you not love what John Williams did with this? How can you not love what Spielberg did with this? And George Lucas, obviously, because it really was their brainchild. And you don't really get much better than this, and neither do movies. So amazing, amazing choice, guys. And now that is going to take us to number 15. Schindler's List from 1993, once again directed by Steven Spielberg. Wow, I'm actually surprised that this one is above Raiders, but then again, maybe I'm not, because a lot of people would, and I think a lot of critics would consider this to be Steven Spielberg's magnum opus, and what is essentially the greatest senior thesis ever made, which is amazing. He submitted this as a senior thesis, and it won, like, the Academy Award for Best Picture. I don't know how you can beat that, but my goodness, this film is just one of the most moving, one of the most touching, one of the most dark, and one of the most disheartening films I've ever seen. Obviously, going back to, you know, what we mentioned so many times in the series, I don't know why they keep coming up, but I guess it just shows how important they were in history, the Nazis and their persecution of the Jewish people. I don't think has ever been put on display to a more horrifying, or at least as in-depth of a degree as it is in this film. My goodness, seeing these, you know, the Holocaust firsthand, well, not firsthand, but you know what I mean, in this narrative is just absolutely horrifying. Just the brutal ways that Spielberg and company came up with writing this film and adapting this, it is just oh man, it's so unsettling. And of course, that you got to give a lot of credit to Ralph Fiennes here is Ammon Goeth. Oh my goodness, one of the most terrifying villains to ever, you know, grace the screen. Every second he's on, he's so unpredictable. You never know if he's just going to he's going to want to shoot someone for fun. I mean, you never know what he's going to do, but every act he makes in this movie is so despicable. But yet, it's such a compelling performance from Fiennes. Maybe he should have won the Oscar. That was a really, really tough year. But my goodness, what he did in this film is absolutely terrifying. But of course, you got to give all the credit to Liam Neeson here as Oscar Schindler, and what is easily his best performance. I think that goes without saying. Earned him a Best Actor nomination that year. And really kind of broke him out as a big star that he later became before he started doing all these action movies that now not many people watch. But this really was such a meaty role for him. And just the progression of Oscar Schindler's character, you kind of see him as a sort of apathetic figure at the beginning of the film, and you really get to see his heart grow tenfold throughout the story. And what he does, I mean, one of the greatest heroes ever, if we're just talking about not even on film but just in real life, because this is obviously based on a true story, and the fact that he saved all these Jews during the Holocaust. I mean, so many lives today are indebted to this man and what he did for these people during this very dark and tumultuous period in history. I mean, there was no darker period ever since or before. So I mean, this really is just such a moving testament to, of course, you know, Spielberg's faith, and you know, it was a big reason why he did this film, to kind of connect with his Jewish roots. But I really think that you couldn't make a better testament to your religion and to your people than this. I mean, my goodness, you know, believe it or not, I don't cry at this movie, but if you're not moved by the ending, I mean, come on, man. You must be heartless or something, because really, it's just astounding. I think that this is his most mature work, for sure, and I can certainly see why people would rank it as his best. This was definitely on my list, though I had it a bit lower down on the list, because, I mean, let's be honest, if it's a Friday night, I'm not going to be like, oh, let's sit down and watch Schindler's List. You know, I'd rather watch, like, Raiders of the Lost Ark or something, but I completely get everyone voting it this high, and, yeah, I mean, this is an absolute masterpiece that had to be on this list.
Just a heartbreakingly tragic film from start to finish. I mean, You hear the stories too about how during the making of the film, the cast and crew would call Robin Williams and have him try to make some jokes just to cheer them up, because the process of making the film was just so hard for everyone involved. But just gave us one of the greatest movies of all time. I mean, tragic, haunting, but beautiful.
Hey, man, that's a great way of putting it. And the fact he came out with this and Jurassic Park in the same year?
Yeah.
It's like, I know we were talking about that before, but, like, it's just absolutely insane to me. One of the best years, maybe the best year ever for any filmmaker. And I think it goes to the show. Like, obviously, it earned him his first Academy Award for Best Director. It shouldn't have been his first, but, you know, he certainly deserved to win it. But, hey, man, I mean, you know, nothing can really you know, soil this film with time. I think with time, this film only gets stronger. I think its message still, you know, just about, you know, the dark depths of humanity and the kind of the triumph over evil is still felt to this day. So really amazing, amazing film. Glad to see it here. Glad to see it make the top 20. And that, guys, is going to take us to number 14.
Play it once, Sam. For all time's sake.
I don't know what you mean, Miss Elsa.
Play it, Sam. Play as time goes by.
Oh, I can't remember it, Miss Elsa. I'm a little rusty on it.
I'll hum it for you.
You must remember this. A kiss is just a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental sentimental things apply as time goes by. And when two lovers woo, they still say I love you. On that you can rely. No matter what the future brings, as time goes by.
Sam, I thought I told you never to play.
Casablanca from 1942, directed by Michael Curtiz. I mean, how could this film not make the top 20? I mean, it's just one of those films that, like, even if you haven't seen it, you know about Casablanca. You know everybody goes to Rick's. This is the greatest romance. Well, this is the greatest romance film of all time. Let me make that stance clear. Because I probably prefer the romance of George and yeah. But anyway, It's a Wonderful Life, can't beat it. But this, I mean, my goodness, how can you knock Humphrey Bogart and Ingrid Bergman, one of the most iconic, one of the sexiest couples to ever grace the screen. And my goodness, I mean, I think this might be the first time we're even talking about Humphrey Bogart on this list, but I mean, this is, once again, one of the greatest performances of all time. Should have won him the Oscar, didn't. I think that's another one of the major crimes that the Academy committed. But this did win the Academy Award for Best Picture, so that was good. But anyway, I mean, this is the definition of what made Bogart such a iconic actor. Probably top five iconic, you know, most iconic actors of all time. It would be hard to say, but his portrayal as Rick Blaine. I think yet again, this is a template for so many characters that came after him. The cynic who doesn't seem like anything kind of bothers him, very kind of laissez-faire when it comes to his own affairs. But then at the end of the film, you see his heart prevail, fight for the side of the good. Just one of the most iconic character archetypes, but I don't think it's been done better than with Rick Blaine. I think one of the greatest characters in all of cinema. Of course, just that dynamic between him and Elsa Lund. I mean, my goodness, when Elsa first shows up on screen, like that scene, you know, we were showing there, as time goes by, play it, Sam. It really is just one of the most subtly and beautifully done scenes. And it's all done with just music and Ingrid Bergman's eyes. Oh my goodness, the definition of natural beauty. But my goodness, that scene to me is one of the greatest scenes in the history of cinema. You could say that about so many scenes in this movie. But before we do, we have to talk about the stack cast. Holy shit. I mean, Paul Heinrich is Victor Laszlo is amazing. Sydney Greenstreet shows up. Peter Lorre, obviously, making another appearance on this list after M. S.Z. Sakal is so hysterical in the couple scenes he shows up. Dooley Wilson, I think even though some of his, you could say the portrayal of his character is a bit diminutive towards, black people, I think he was like the first, that was like one of the first times that you really saw like this strong, you know, this kind of like strong character that a lot of people had respect for. Especially he's the one who kind of stands up to Rick. In a couple instances, he knows what's best for him, and yeah, I mean, just such an iconic portrayal. But to me, Claude Rains, another one, he should have won an Oscar for this movie, man. Just the absolutely like apathetic sort of, you know, he's like, which direction is the wind blowing in today, you know, sort of character. He is the definition of you know, no scruples whatsoever, but he's so effortlessly charming, so hysterical, brings so much humor to this. I love that scene where it's like, Rick, I am shocked to find gambling here. Here's your winnings, sir. Thank you. It's just absolutely amazing. But my goodness, just this story is so timeless. Once again, same era as Schindler's List, so that really works out. But the fact that, like, when they're writing this film, like, they didn't even know if they were going to win the war, which I think goes to show just how inherently powerful the writing of this film is, especially that La Versailles scene. Last time I was watching it, like, that's one of my new favorite scenes, man. It just brings tears to my eye. Like, when that one woman is, like, crying, like, that was actually a genuine reaction, because, as I said, they didn't know what was going to happen unlike we do with all, you know, years of hindsight. Just absolutely amazing. And look, this to me is probably top two greatest screenplays ever written. The dialogue is so insatiable, so snappy, so clever. Every single second, the words just leap off the screen out of these actors' mouths. I mean, there's nothing like it. After you hear this movie, you just want to talk like these characters for the rest of your life, and then maybe afterwards. And dude, maybe like one of the most quotable films of all time, whether it be, you know, of all the gin joints and all the towns and all the world, she walked into mine. Or, you know, there's so many iconic lines. And of course, the "here's looking at you, kid." I mean, everybody knows that. Maybe the most iconic line from this movie. I could go on and on about how quotable this is, how hysterical it is, one of the funniest movies of all time. But yet again, it's just that tragic romance that occurs between you know, these two characters, in just reveals itself in so many touching ways. It's just unbelievable. And look, this was my favorite movie of all time for a while. It kind of dropped out of my top 10 last time I watched it. Maybe it was based on circumstance, but there are a few films that I think excite me a bit more than Casablanca. But I'd be remiss to say that this isn't one of my favorites of all time, and one of the greatest films ever made. Absolutely deserves to be this high on the list. And I think probably Warner Brothers' crowning achievement from their studio. Maybe.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, like you said, the characters, the casting. Humphrey Bogart is just so cool. Like, who doesn't want to be Humphrey Bogart, right? But no, everything you've said is true. This is one of the movies, you know, when you talk about, you know, Citizen Kane, Godfather, this is up there with them. And yeah, couldn't be a better choice for the list.
Are you shocked it's not in the top 10, though?
I am a little bit, I gotta be honest, but happy to see it nonetheless.
Yeah, honestly, I think I might have had it like a spot higher, but this is honestly a perfect spot for it. Though it probably should have made the top 10. If I'm being completely honest. But hey, I'm not mad seeing it number 14. I mean, you gotta have it here. My goodness, and that ending, man, one of the best endings of all time. You know, Louis, I think this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship, and really one of the most beautiful beginnings to an entire era of film that, you know, I think there's been better films since then, but it's just, there's nothing like it, man, and there's nothing like Casablanca. So absolutely incredible, timeless masterpiece, deserving of the spot, and that is going to take us now to number 13.
Trying you. You talking to me? You talking to me? You talking to me? Well, then who the hell else are you talking to? Talking to me? Well, I'm the only one here. Who the fuck do you think you're talking to?
Taxi Driver, directed by Martin Scorsese from 1976. Only the second appearance of Martin Scorsese on the list, but I think it goes to show this is only second appearance of Scorsese on the list. Says something about how amazing of a director he is. One of the greatest of all time. And a lot of people would say, like I was saying with Raging Bull, I think people would say this is his best directed movie. And I would probably go with this one, to be honest. Not only did it really put Scorsese on the map, because sure, he made Mean Streets, right? He made a couple of things before, but this was the one that people were like, oh, who's this guy? And I think that this is one of the best directed movies ever made. I think this might be the best character study of all time. I mean, let's be honest, of Travis Bickle here, played by Robert De Niro, and yet again, one of the other greatest performance of all time. The fact that two performances in my top 10 favorite performances of all time belong to Robert De Niro, I think goes to show and say something about what an amazing actor he is. I wish he was still doing stuff like this today, man, because my goodness, when he... This really cemented De Niro, I think, too. Well, obviously, he already won an Oscar for Godfather 2, but this, to me... My goodness, just this dark character exploration into you know the muck and the grime of the city. And I think it's so brilliant the fact that he is a taxi driver, because you get to see how he experiences it through his eyes, you know, just the kind of the fog rising up from the streets, the dirt and all the trash on the side of the road. But yet it's so beautiful the way it's juxtaposed against the beautiful Bernard Herrmann score. So jazzy, so sexy. Maybe the best score he ever did. I don't know, because Psycho's pretty iconic, but I mean, the fact that this was like his last too. I mean, what a way to go out if this was his last. Just amazing, amazing score. And everybody in this movie as well. You got the introduction of Jodie Foster in an Oscar-nominated performance here. Really put her on the map. Incredible what she does. And, I mean, what a complicated role for a child actor. Not that she was a child, but, you know, she's a minor. And just kind of like the ideas that this film brings up about child prostitution. Like, all these different things. And the underlying message of what it has to say about the impact of the Vietnam War, because I know because Travis Bickle is like, you know, a veteran, and yet they never really make a big deal about it, but it's very subtle how you see the psychological ramifications, how he has this very skewed idea of the world and what's appropriate. Like when he takes a Sybil Shepherd character, when she takes Sybil Shepherd's character, Betsy, on the date to the pornographic theater. I mean, I think that tells you everything you need to know about Travis Bickle. But at the heart of the story, it really is, you still somehow feel sympathy for him, because it really is a story about this lonely guy who kind of goes mad because of his own seclusion. And just to see that transformation from De Niro is absolutely incredible. I mean, this is yet again another example of just amazing method acting. The way he jacks himself up too, by the end of the it's horrifying, like what he's doing in this performance. And of course, "You talking to me? You talking to me?" I mean, one of the most iconic lines and one of the most iconic scenes in all of cinema. I mean, there's just so many moments in here. I think this is one of those films, it's just the more you watch it, the more you get out of it. Just the deep analytical you know, nature of this film is really what makes it, I think Scorsese's most rewarding film intellectually speaking. But my goodness, I mean, you could say so many things, and just the fact, like, the way you could interpret the ending, which I think I will spoil, just because it's like, either, you know, you could say Travis Bickle died there and this is like him kind of like imagining this in the afterlife, and or, you know, like, and how he sees himself as a hero, or you could see like how basically the public only perceives what they can actually see, and how one like wrong turn, like if he assassinated that politician, he would have been seen as like this villain, and yet since he kind of like went out of his way to assassinate, you know, this kind of like child prostitute ring, everyone sees him as a hero. And just small decisions like that, well, I wouldn't say that's a small decision, but you know what I mean, just like anything, it could just switch on its head at any moment, and your perception of this character could be switched. I think any interpretation is valid, but that's the one I like to buy into, because I think it has the most social implications in something that I think is scarily true even to this day, which is probably why Taxi Driver has just gone on to be such a classic. And just so many amazing shots, too, that are just the definition of visual storytelling here, and really epitomize the loneliness of Travis Bickle's character. I mean, how can you not love this movie? There actually are some people who don't. You know who I'm talking about if you're watching. But yeah, I think this is an absolute masterpiece. It's in my top 20, probably right around this spot, maybe a little lower, but yeah, absolutely deserving a spot this high on the list.
Totally agree with you. I just love the performances in this movie, especially De Niro. Yeah. I mean, obviously he's great. No one else could have played that role, I don't think. Excellent direction by Scorsese. It truly is one of the greatest films ever made, and I think it's in a great spot on this list, personally.
Yeah, man. And dude, can you believe, like, Scorsese wasn't even nominated for Best Director? Yeah. That's, like, yet again, I keep talking about the Academy and snubbing so many amazing, like, performances or work in films, but dude, like, look, I love Rocky, but John G. Avildsen over Martin Scorsese? No way, man. And also, like, I think De Niro should have won the Oscar for this as well, because I always had that argument where Peter Finch, he should have been supporting for Network. I don't understand why he won the Oscar, because he's amazing in that film, but nothing can beat this. Not even Stallone and Rocky, man. I mean, this is just next level work in a, as I said, like, probably top 10 greatest performances of all time if I really had to narrow it down, which I hope to do sometime soon. But yeah, I mean, look, absolutely deserving this high on the list. Glad to see Scorsese make the list once again. And that, guys, is going to take us to number 12.
Slow ahead. I can go slow ahead. Come on down and chump some of this shit.
You knew I had to make the list some point or another. Jaws, directed by, once again, Steven Spielberg, 3-in-1 episode. Look, from 1975, I think this is Spielberg's best film. This is in my top 10 favorite films of all time. And, wow, the fact that Spielberg has 6 movies on this list, more than any other director, I think speaks volumes as to how much everybody loves him as a filmmaker. And this really was the one that broke him out. And I still think, amongst all the magnum opuses you could say he has, this really is his magnum opus. I really don't think there's been a film in his filmography, which is saying a lot, but just the cultural impact that this film had cannot be understated. Not only did it keep people out of the water for years to come and scared of sharks, which, you know, could have had its own sort of, you know, natural implications, which are kind of detrimental, but just from blockbuster filmmaking and how films were marketed, this changed everything. This was originally going to come out in December. I'm sure you know this story, but it's originally going to come out in December, and they're like, no, we have to push it to the summer. And then basically it revolutionized summer blockbusters. Like, every year we're like, what is going to be the big summer blockbuster? Like, last year was Top Gun Maverick. What's it going to be this year? Spider-Verse? I don't know. Probably Mission Impossible, anytime Tom Cruise gets a spot. But regardless, this might be, well, this is the definitive blockbuster. Let's just put it that way. But really, I feel like before I saw this movie, I knew, you know, its reputation obviously preceded it. But I was like, oh, this killer shark movie? Like, I knew everyone said it was amazing. But when I actually sat down and watched it, I was like, I get it. Because it isn't just it isn't like this novelty idea of, like, the shark going around and killing people. And obviously, if you guys seen my review on this, you know how I feel about it. But it's really the characters. Once again, I think Spielberg is so great at not only directing actors, but really emphasizing, you know, these characters' problems and just they're so well defined in here, especially with Roy Scheider as Chief Brody, man. I mean, what an iconic hero in this film. You really see the film through his eyes and everything occurring around him. It's just absolutely brilliant what he does in this movie. But yet, so many other people. Richard Dreyfuss as Matt Hooper. My goodness, one of his most iconic roles. To me, though, the real standout, and he should have been nominated for an Oscar, I don't know how he wasn't, Robert Shaw as Quentin here. Oh my goodness, as soon as he comes in and he scratches his nails on the chalkboard, one of the most, like, it just does not sit well with me every time I hear it, and it makes me cringe. But he really makes his impact on the film, by far the most interesting character. And dude, just that whole monologue about the USS Indianapolis is, as I've said before and I'll say again, like, one of the greatest scenes in the history of cinema. I think that whole scene just by itself is the epitome of what makes cinema great. It has humor, and through that humor it reveals character, and yet it has this amazing sense of pathos, rich drama. It's just everything that cinema can be is embodied in that scene. And I just think that you really can't beat it as one of the greatest scenes of all time. And I think by far my favorite scene in the movie. But this is one of those cases, happy accidents, man. They wanted the shark to work. And then when it didn't, they're like, let's do POVs. And set to John Williams' amazing, ever so iconic score. This could even be considered as most iconic after Star Wars. I don't know. But everyone knows that. Da-da-da-da. You know, like this, those two tones going back and forth. And really, just I think one of the most brilliant uses of POVs ever. And I just think everything about this film, none of the characters are really two-dimensional. Even like the mayor in the town, like once you get to that scene after the attack on the beach and you hear him say like, my kids were on that beach, it really recontextualizes how you feel about him, but also this whole story. It's such a human story at its core. Even it's about this killer shark, and the action's incredible, still holds up to this day. The scares are still like, they still jump out at you. You could say this is a horror film, and I think that is true. I see it more as a thriller, but a couple scenes in this film are still kind of horrifying to this day. And what can you say? I mean, so iconic in so many ways, but of course, you know, we're going to need a bigger boat is probably the line that everybody knows and loves, uttered by Roy Scheider there as Brody. I mean, you don't really get much better than this. I feel like he really, not that this was his first film, but for a film this huge, I think Spielberg really came out swinging and proved why he is one of the greatest filmmakers of all time. Arguably, I think in the top two. This really is just undeniable, a masterpiece from top to bottom, just from a cultural standpoint, from a filmmaking standpoint. Yeah, I mean, what else can you say about Jaws that hasn't been said already? It's an absolute masterpiece. And yeah, maybe it could have even made the top 10. I think it should have, but number 12, hey, that's pretty close, so I'll take it.
Yeah, man, definitely. I mean, there's a reason this movie put Spielberg on the map. You pretty much covered all the bases. I mean, the characters are great. The actors are great. And just, like you said, I love the story of the happy accidents. It just, you know, compromise that ended up in a better film, even though obviously the sequels are nowhere close to the first one. I gotta agree, even though Raiders is my favorite, this is my second favorite Spielberg. It truly is a masterpiece.
Yeah, because that's the thing with Spielberg, you can really go back and forth. Like I was saying before, like I could go back and forth for the second spot with E.T. and Raiders. I mean, it doesn't really matter, but this I feel like is just a notch above. You know what I mean? Like, and I saw this in IMAX when they re-released it. Oh my goodness, dude, that was one of the best theater experiences ever. I think everybody was so into the movie too, and by the end, you know, we all broke out in applause. I mean, how can you not applaud for a film this revolutionary, this iconic? Everything about it is amazing. I'm going to sound like a broken record if I go on about it any further, but I'm really glad to see that Spielberg got so much love on this list. I mean, could have gone to so many other filmmakers, but six films, that's just wild to me, but not surprising at all, and absolutely deserved at the end of the day. So, yeah, I mean, so glad to see Jaws this high on the list, even if it could be a couple spots higher. But that's absolutely fine by me. So, yeah, guys, that will now take us to number 11. A Space Odyssey, directed by, once again, Stanley Kubrick from 1968. And look, a lot of people would say that this is Stanley Kubrick's best film. I would have to agree. It's his highest on the list. Surprised Kubrick didn't make the top 10, but I can't really argue this whatsoever. Four films on the list, that's nothing to scoff at either. But look, I mean, this is one of the best made films. This might be the best directed film of all time. I don't know. Even though it just, you know, you're floating out in space and it feels like it's taking forever. The thing that's so impressive to me about this film, despite kind of its slow-burning nature, is how amazing the visual effects are. I think to me, this is even, and I think this is a better film too, keep in mind, but this is more groundbreaking than Star Wars to me in so many levels, especially the visuals, because without the practical models that Kubrick made for this film, I don't think we would have had Star Wars in its present state. Not to say that Lucas and company couldn't have gotten to that point, but this really set the groundwork for so many films to follow. And I even saw some of the models at the Academy Museum, which were pretty incredible, as well as the suits that were kind of worn throughout the filming. But just, this is a film that I kind of know like the back of my hand. Like, this is a film I could break down like that, and I probably will here in just a minute. Just the way it starts out, like, this whole film is obviously about the advancement of technology and of human nature, just starting up from that brilliant sequence with the apes, you know, learning to use the tool from the first time, and maybe the greatest match cut in the history of cinema, when he throws the bone up in the air, and then you get that spaceship, and it automatically, the linkage it creates between these time periods, but also just one of the greatest examples of intellectual montage I've ever seen on film. And yet, this is probably the best example of a film talking about the ideas of, you know, kind of man's creation surpassing their own intellect. Of course, emblemized in the most brilliant character in this movie, HAL 9000, voiced by Douglas Rain. This one of the greatest villains of all time, and yet he's just like a floating dot on the screen, and he's so scary, he's so intimidating, and yet his arc is so heartbreaking. And I just love how none of the other human characters are there. It's a very sterile environment Kubrick creates through these visuals with the white and everything, and I think that also plays into kind of like the thematic elements as well. When everything goes down, you really feel for Hal, because he's the only one who seems to show any true emotion, which I think that is one of the most brilliantly written characters in the history of cinema. As limited as his screen time is, he makes such a tremendous impact. But my goodness, to me, the reason this film, because this got knocked out of my top 10, it's a few spots lower, I think maybe because, it is slow. It doesn't make it bad or anything, but there's a couple movies I'd rather watch more, like Jaws. Like, I could have flip-flopped these two, and that would have been even better. But look, that whole journey through, like, is it Jupiter?
I think so.
Well, regardless,
not sure, but
once you go on that psychedelic journey, man, that scene, that whole sequence is literally LSD, right? But it is just so absolutely mesmerizing. It's hypnotic. You can't take your eyes off it. The editing is absolutely incredible, and just to this journey, for, you know, man to find something even greater than they've already, you know, have been. I guess I don't want to give too much away for those who haven't seen it, but to me, that ending is what really makes this film have all its impact that it has had, despite the technical stuff. This is just such a genius film, and the example, once again, of visual storytelling. I mean, you could go back. I usually go back and forth whether this is the best directed film of all time or The Godfather, but my goodness, the fact that this wasn't even nominated for Best Picture is heinous. And the fact that this was Kubrick's only Oscar for visual effects is insane to me, because, I mean, how can you not award this film the highest honor that the film industry can give? Because this really, as time has shown, because this was another film that was mixed when it came out. And I could understand this a bit more than It's a Wonderful Life, because it is very cerebral. Not everyone's going to get it as soon as it comes out. But I think over time, this is a film that once again has revealed itself to be an intellectual masterpiece. It is just so amazing from top to bottom, the filmmaking here. Even if you aren't into it as much, nobody can deny that. But yeah, this is a slow burn if I've ever seen one, and probably the greatest slow burn of all time, if you will. 2001, A Space Odyssey is an absolute sci-fi masterpiece that deserves every accolade that it's received throughout history.
You mentioned during Jaws that you went to see this in IMAX, and I went to see this in IMAX with you.
We were, yes, we went.
Yes, a great experience and a great film. I mean, it's like you said, the filmmaking is out of this world, no pun intended.
Yeah, literally.
The special effects, I mean,
fake the moon landing,
they still, yeah, exactly. The special effects still look amazing, even blown up on an IMAX screen. It just truly is a mind-blowing film. And I think it's highly deserving of this spot.
Yeah, man. This is hard to argue. Once again, as I said, this is a round where I had it on my list. And honestly, kind of surprised this didn't make the top 10. I would have thought this would have been one of those films that would have been there. For a while, it was like well in the top 5. But I just think, you know, maybe some people don't love it as much as, you know, some others. So maybe that's why it didn't quite crack the top 10. But 11, I mean, come on. That's still like... Obviously, most people think insanely highly of this film, and I know we both do, especially myself. And yeah, I mean, how can you not love this film? It's amazing, and definitely Kubrick's masterpiece, his greatest masterpiece among many. So yeah, guys, wow, we are almost to the top 10. I'm sure you guys have kind of narrowed it down to this point, but I'd love to hear what you think is going to make the top 10. In the comments below. We're going to split it up over 2 episodes. We're going to bring in a couple of very special guests, so be on the lookout for that when it comes out. And Alex, thank you so much for joining me on this episode. It's such a pleasure to talk movies whenever we get the chance to. And tell us, where can the good people find you if they're seeking you out here?
Instagram, I'm aprevo99. Twitter, I think, is the same. So you can find me there. And Nathaniel, thanks for having me on the show. And really looking forward to seeing this last episode. So
yeah, absolute pleasure, man. I mean, these last couple are really just going to be chock full of absolute masterpieces, basically. And yeah, all amazing films. Once again, you guys did an amazing, amazing job of voting on this list. And I think the top 10 is going to reflect that. So please, if you haven't already, please smash that like button, subscribe to the channel. You're already this far in though, so I don't know. We'll see if you haven't subscribed yet, but please do if you haven't. And of course, let me know if you're enjoying this series. I'm so glad I could do this for you, even though it's like draining all my time. That's kind of okay, because I enjoy talking about movies as well, and sharing this with you guys. And thank you for voting on the series. And yeah, guys, we will see you once we get to the top 10. So until then, take it easy now.